Boy, that was at the 379-foot mark. Bob Gibson joins the list of pitchers who have hit home runs in World Series competition.
Baseball game is great, but you can't get this excited.
They were just not going to a baseball game or a football game. They could say, hey, I'm going to the hockey game.
People go crazy in that. No wide open play they have at the arena.
You actually feel like you're really sucked into some kind of a momentum of the team.
What do you like most about the game?
Oh, the excitement, the body contact.
It was good entertainment.
We were talking and Dad said, well, look, we can't find a name. I just think the greatest name in the world is we'll just call them the St. Louis Blues. And geez, we all lit up. You know, we were stunned. What really was a great name. And of course, Jim Cullen comes up. He says, well, if we do this, the Jim Handy Estate will probably say we were open to a lawsuit. And Dad said, that's more reason. Now we're definitely going to call them the St. Louis Blues.
Sidney Sullen, a great name. Worked hard to bring this franchise to St. Louis. Lynn Patrick and Scotty Bowman did a fantastic job of finding talent.
Montreal's Expo 67 was a showcase for the entire world. Also that year, in June, Montreal was the location of much hockey activity as owners, managers, coaches, and scouts got together to officially form the six new teams, which would double the number of clubs in the NHL.
We were just a bunch of boys coming down from Canada, and we really didn't know what we were up against when we got to St. Louis.
Tremendous all the way around. How do you feel?
Well, you can't express your feelings, Les, because it was a great series. I think both teams played as best they could, and it was just a break that decided it, and I think we were due for some breaks.
Hey, Ron! Hey, Ron! 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 Congratulations on scoring that winning goal. How do you feel?
Very, very happy.
Well, that's awesome.
Glenn Hall, who was Mr. Goalie, and I think that's the first thing I wanted to see was if he, you know, he got sick before games, and I was so surprised that he did. You know, you hear about it, but you got to see it firsthand.
I threw up because I probably felt I contributed more. I had to be ready. I was ready to play as well as I was capable of the game. And I didn't like to play anything except at the level that was the highest I could attain.
It's an accomplishment that comes to very few, and certainly a man that is deserving of an award of this stature to be the most valuable player to his team during the full playoffs. Yeah, to me, it was a wonderful choice, and the best man won.
In the four games, two went into overtime, and the other two were by a single goal. So we were close enough, but close it. Too bad it wasn't horseshoes, I guess.
Now, those days, the people was coming down to see good hockey game and was good, rough, and tough. Was not cruel with hockey stick, but a good body check, or sometimes I used to drop my gloves, or Bobby used to drop the gloves and a little punch in the nose, but didn't hurt me because I was punching first.
Noel Picard became a great favorite with fans in St. Louis, as did one of their original defensemen, Al Arbour.
Taking Al Arbour, even up and down for years from Toronto to Rochester, and played briefly in Chicago and played in Detroit. But he came here and he felt appreciated.
I retired. I quit again. I said, I'm going back home. So I said, I better go and rest. So I rested back in Montreal, and they called me just prior to the playoffs. I always liked the playoffs.
During all the playoffs this season, veteran Dickie Moore scored 7 goals and 7 assists.
Noel Picard, Gary Sabourin, those guys had to work for what they got. They were not the so-called gifted, talented, you know, outstanding stars, but they always got the job done.
Those memories of the first year are the memories that always live with me. Those are the things that make me a Blues fan.
From the faceoff, Johnson into the corner. Picard for the Blues plays it to Ab McDonald. He couldn't get it out of there. Al Berenson catches up with him, comes across center. Berenson around Van Impe, right in on goal. He shoots, he scores! On the board for McCurry, ahead of center to Berenson. Berenson knocks it by Van Impe and has a break. Berenson right in, he shoots. He scores! Here's Picard at center. Pass for Henry. Henry, a great pass to Berenson. A shot, he scores! Here's Camille Henry. Pass ahead to Berenson, who has a breakaway at center. Berenson in. He shoots. He scores! Van Impe, who has broken his stick, is back to get it. Lost it to McCurry. He's in with Berenson. Berenson shoots. He scores!
Van Hip lofts it to Berenson. Berenson has a break. One man back. Here he comes. A shot. He scores!
And, you know, he could have had 7 goals.
He should have got 8.
I remember saying to myself, thank God I can still score. So I obviously was not on a roll going into the game. There was a lot of excitement in St. Louis, and the Solomons bought me a new car and a canoe, and the players chipped in and gave me a shotgun.
Worked hard all year, and right from the start they took first place right from training camp, and they've continued right on, so you'd have to take your hats off to them right now.
Hey, that's great. That'll ruin my reputation.
How do you feel about this, Mr. Sullivan?
Well, you can imagine it's been a long time coming, and we're all thrilled all the way.
Well, those fans were really excited out there tonight, weren't they?
I don't think they were any more excited than we were, but we were all excited together.
What about the playoffs coming up now?
Well, I'm sure Scotty will keep the boys up high.
Did you ever figure that hockey would go over like it has in St. Louis?
No, I thought it would go over, but I don't think anyone would visualize this.
Pass to Billy McCrory and on to Frank St. Marseille. They're in over the Canadian line. St. Marseille shooting, he scores! Frank St. Marseille! He's taken into the boards by Redmond and Savard. Here's St. Marseille in over the line with a Mystery Gray. They score! The Blues!
Thank you.
All I wanted when I was young was to play one game for the big team of our school. I never thought that someday I'd play in the NHL. And I never thought that someday I'd win that Vezina Trophy. And it was through the St. Louis Blues that I had a chance to come back and win it again. And with the help of Dan Hall, like I said before, quite a good backup man.
There were three of them. And would you believe that it was Emil Francis who traded all three Plager brothers to St. Louis?
Could always beat up me, but I didn't have to worry. I had my younger brother, Billy. I could always give it to him.
Don't ever think of getting traded. Think that you're going to be here right to the end, and that sweater is always going to be on you. So, you know, respect it and go out and play as hard as you can for it.
I've looked up to him, you know, all my life. He always was ahead of me in hockey. He went away to play junior. He played professional hockey before I did. You always want to be as good as your brother. In fact, there's a little jealousy sometimes. I think if you got a brother that's there, it helps because you always want to do better than your brother. And I've always tried to do better than Bark, or I'm going to do better than him. There's no way I ever could. He was the greatest. He was the best we've had in St. Louis.
Lynn Patrick, heretofore the club's general manager, has been elevated to the position of managing director, overseeing the team's entire operation. Scotty Bowman, who was appointed as coach after the first 16 games of last season, will serve as general manager and coach.
I heard so much about St. Louis. I know for a fact the fans are just great down here, because when I was with New York, we'd come and play here. I'm telling you, we had goose pimples just hearing them clap and shout and whatnot.
St. Louis was the team because I knew Scotty Bowman. I've known him for about 10, 15 years.
Trying to get around in front. He's in front of the goal. He'll hit the goal post. Hit the goal post. And it's fired over to the boards. Now it's Busick on the left side. Busick trying to come around in front. Getting it over on the point to Stanfield. His shot. Oh, and hit Plant and knocked him flat. Plant is hurt on the play.
Boy, he really took a winger. Freddie Stanfield wound up, and he has a tremendous shot. A slap shot. It's wicked. Jacques Plant was crouched. He was trying to follow the flight of the puck, and it looked like it hit Jacques right on the forehead. He's lying right on his stomach, flat on the ice.
We started to work on the mask that I could use in a game, but it wasn't until 1959 that we found that we could wear one.
In over the Boston line, Blues with the extra man. Back on the point to Jimmy Roberts. His shot is wide of the goal. Goyette in front. Oh, and Keenan shoots. He scores! Larry Keenan. Westfall is trying to get it out. Does to Sanderson. And his shot is kicked by Talbot, and it goes over to the boards. Bobby Orr's in there, too. Orr shoots. He scores! It's all over! Bobby Orr!
All of a sudden, number nine, Frank St. Marseille, skates in and zips one in. And I thought of when the Saints go marching in, so I went into that.
They used to sing, you know, when the Blues come marching in, and the hair on the back of your neck would stick up.
I know myself, going out on the ice, no matter how you felt before the game, it just pumped you up and made you feel 10 feet tall.
I remember listening to KMOX Radio and Dan Kelly, the voice of the Blues, saying he shoots, he scores.
And across the line, Berenson in on goal. He shoots, he scores! In on goal, he shoots, he scores! He shoots, he scores! In on goal, he shoots, he scores!
It's been a real barn burner here tonight.
We were family in St. Louis, and I think, you know, the early years, everybody that wanted to get traded, they always wanted to get traded to St. Louis.
It's not only the things that he did for you, it's the way he treated you.
They weren't accustomed to normal owner-player relationships, and it wasn't unusual for the Solomons to have the whole team over to their home for dinner or for a movie, and they got very close to the players.
Here's this man that says, hey, come on, after we win this thing, we're going down to Florida. I mean, we never heard of Florida.
Solomon's picked up the arena. There was even blue water in the Johns. You know, he was so proud of everything, blue, blue, blue. The place was spotless. It was like living in your own home. You couldn't have asked for a better place to view a hockey game.
We had a tough game in, it was Oakland. And one of our players comes off, and he's mad, and he took a sweater and takes it off and throws the sweater on the floor. Well, Dickie Moore got up, picked up the sweater, and went over and grabbed the guy by the underwear, put him against the wall, and he says, "This sweater, this blue note, it's your life." In Montreal, the crest of the sweater has never hit a floor. That blue note never hits the floor. You wear that sweater with pride.
If you play for a team, you got to be proud of the sweater. You know, especially when you come up out of junior, that you got to be proud of the team sweater that you're with.
We were very fortunate that we did end up in St. Louis, and we loved the city. The city was great for the players. It was really easy for us to play as well as we were capable of.
The original St. Louis Blues story is such a great story because it was a speck of time that, you know, there's only a handful of people like that 30 or 40,000 that used to come to those games that really know what we're talking about. And it was magic.
This is Mr. Bowman, and Scotty is the number one guy. He runs the club.
I think Al earned the respect of the players because of the type of player that he was. And being a captain for 3 years, I think we have a natural leader.
We all got together at Disney on Parade and took a vote and decided that you were just the super coach of the year.
They weren't playing up to their potential, and we just hope that a coaching change will make them a better hockey club.
Is it not possible that maybe I shouldn't be here and maybe they shouldn't have me? Is that not possible? Is that possible? I mean, that's about the size of it.
I don't believe in screaming and yelling at the player. You don't have to.
The Blues once again, and I say this with much sorrow and much regret, are making a coaching change.
I think that even this year, they weren't even counting on us making the playoffs.
Into Unger, the shot, he scores! Unger on a drive, he scores! Unger right in on goal, shoot, he scores! Unger, that's a slap shot, so he scores!
Unger was a great goal scorer, that's, and a tough, tough kid. Took a lot of punishment.
His philosophy on the game itself, the way he played it, was I have to be in there. I have to be in there. And no matter what pain is, I know I can help the team.
There's a fight, it seems to get more response out of the fans than anything, really. So there might be a few people that don't like it, but I think probably most of them do like, you know, the fighting or the rough play in a game. It's hard to really plant yourself to throw a good solid punch at anyone. So you see a lot of big guys that are supposed to be tough, but they're not that good on their skates, and it's hard for them to get their balance sometimes. And myself, I like to get one hand on the guy, you know, and mostly on his right shoulder here, so he can't hit me with his right hand, and then you got a little stability there, you know, you can get some power behind your punches. It's always been part of the game. The game, I don't know how old it is, maybe 75 years old, and it's always been part of the game. I don't know why they want to take it out now all of a sudden.
Gasser and I felt the same way. There's never going to be a more dominating physical player in the game than Bobby Gassoff.
Memorial Day weekend, 7 o'clock Sunday night, I got a call from Bob Plager. Tell me that Bob Gassoff had been involved in an accident out of Gary Unger's farm, and that I should get right out to the hospital, which I did. By the time I got there, Bob Gassoff had died.
And we were at the funeral, and even Francis come up to me, he says, you know, Tommy, he says, we're an hour away from not ever playing another game in St. Louis.
I remember receiving letters just addressed to the St. Louis Blues. Here's a dollar. I can give you a dollar a week to help support your team. Don't leave St. Louis. I love you.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're gathered here today for what we feel is an important event, and that's to announce a tentative arrangement for the Ralston Carina Company to take over the franchise of the St. Louis Blues and to keep the St. Louis Blues in St. Louis.
With the Ralston Carina in on it now, we know from fact that they don't believe in finishing second. They want to finish first.
No, it's just a few things, I think, with the team. You know, one player is not going to make the difference, that's for sure, myself. But see, it's good to be back.
If you can lose 12 in a row, you can win 12 in a row. We're not the Montreal Canadiens. There's a lot of teams that are like three or four anyway. They're definitely better than we are.
You'll be up the top of the mountain. You'll be down in the bottom of the valley. And the thing is to keep your head and keep your cool at all times and learn your lessons from those type of things.
Somebody made a big statue for him. They put him out in the building and it rusted. You know, well, Gary Unger would never rust.
Dear Montreal, Boston, Buffalo, Chicago, and the rest of our friends in the National Hockey League. This is just a gentle reminder that you're in for a few surprises, because the new St. Louis Blues have put the check back in the Checkerdome.
better competitor than Brian Sutter. He, in my mind, is outstanding. He's a real leader, and regardless of what Brian Sutter does, when he's through playing hockey, right now he farms. If he continues to farm, he'll be the best farmer in Alberta. If he decides that he wants to open up a popcorn stand, he'll be the best popcorn stand in Alberta.
You guys go on, I'll talk to Brian. I'm gonna go down and talk to the goal judge now because I'm required to do so. I saw that puck go right up underneath the crossbar. I'm right on the goal line, Brian. I have perfect eyesight, perfect vision. Okay? All right? All right, I'm gonna go check with him. No, sir, Brian. Why would I lie to you?
It's been a situation where I've been very lucky. I've been very fortunate to be able to play with guys like that. Brian's been great on the left side.
It's supposed to be the best league in the world, and among there's 21 teams in the league, and I'm on one of those 21 teams, and I'm damn proud of it.
We really did have a great team in 80-81. We had all the holes were filled. I think at the time, Mr. Francis had made so many deals that I think we had 7 or 8 first-round picks on our teams. A lot of them were from other organizations, but I think it showed that we did have a lot of talent. We had all the holes filled. We had great goaltending. We had good defense. We had good scores. We could do it all.
And LaPointe for the Blues feeds to Curry on right wing at center ice. To Mike Zook. Zook into the Detroit zone. Zook trying to carry through. Drops it to Curry. Score! Curry! And the Blues have a 2-goal lead again.
Everyone literally had their best season, right from our defenseman up to our forwards, and they all had literally their best season ever to date, and the team worked hard together, and there was a little bit of that old St. Louis Blues chemistry.
With a minute left in the game, Reed Larson lost it in front. Curry should be scored!
I guess I've been involved running National Hockey League clubs for the last 22 years. And to me, that had to be one of the most exciting seasons in my career, because from December 28th on, the building was packed.
Quadruco, in along the board, jams up with a couple of Penguins. Up comes to Curry. Curry in front of the net.
I think Mike Liute showed that he was a dominant NHL goalkeeper. Going into that season, I don't think anyone realized that.
The team got to be known as the St. Liute Blues. Bob Plager became famous for a scouting report. It was every night, just play Liute. And he played every night almost and was terrific.
Mike Liute that year played as good in goal as any goalkeeper I've ever seen.
Turnbull comes up at the puck but couldn't clear it. Now the honest shot, rebound! Oh, and Liute stopped it from close there. King center. Here's Larry Murphy. Hit the goalpost. Murphy hit the goalpost. Another shot. And Liute stops that. Now Brownside will clearing it. To Turnbull at center. Turnbull. To Tom Dean. Shoots it in empty net. He scores! Tom
Dean! We won our division, but we went right down to the last weekend fighting with the New York Islanders, who'd won a couple straight Stanley Cups for first place.
Even though we went right down to the wire, I felt we could have won the first place overall, and that was very important with the teams rated on a 1 to 21 scale. Our team showed a lot of pride, a lot of character, and a lot of talent for a team that wasn't supposed to be in the top 10.
Now we're working hard, boys. We're working hard every shift. Let's not relax. You defensemen, when you shoot that puck, look where you're shooting it and get it down. Look for a forward stick. Eagle. Good play.
It was the fifth and deciding game here at the arena against Pittsburgh. And Greg Millen was the goaltender for Pittsburgh and was playing terrifically. And he was dancing to the Budweiser song that Ernie Hayes was playing on the organ.
And it was anyone's game. We went into overtime. And Mike Crombien and Mike Zook, as it turned out, had been our two extra forwards that hadn't played much. And they didn't see any ice at all in the overtime. We were going with three lines. And the team was tiring, and both teams were having great scoring chances. It was one of those games that either team could have won several times.
Baxter dumps it into the St. Louis zone. In goes Shutt after it. He missed it. And Federico for the Blues cleared it, but not out. The Vera shot. That's blocked. And back comes Sutter. With Federico. Two on one break. Sutter moving in. To Federico. To Sutter. Oh, in the field. To Rob Sutter, who was in alone. And Pittsburgh cleared away. A passing comes out on the left wing and gives it to Micheletti. He puts it. Beatty couldn't get it out. The Penguins hold it in. Here's Kehoe. Shooting Williams. Also the Blues clears it, and Chapman has a breakaway. Chapman moving in, shoots for the save. Now Chapman back to the goal for the Blues. Centers it, and Carlisle cleared it away. Here's Maxwell, shooting, he shot wide, and Pittsburgh comes back. Rodney shot the center ice on left wing. Shot, drops it to Malone to lead, and he shot wide. Back comes Curry to Federico. Federico to center, he's checked by Carlisle. And Carlisle comes back for Pittsburgh. Across the line to Kehoe, to Johnson in on goal. Williams to save.
Going into the second overtime, I decided to play Mike Zouk and Crombie, and I put Zouk out on one shift, and he looked a lot faster than he normally would have looked, I think because both teams were tiring. The next shift, I put Mike Crombie out on the ice.
Crombie had the flu that night. He's not a great goal scorer. Hadn't played, I don't think, since the first period.
LaPointe in across the line in the Pittsburgh zone. He tries to center one. Zouk gets it back to the goal. It's put to Crombie. Yeah! Mike Crombie! And the goal is on the save!
It just kept building. And we couldn't believe it. It was just unbelievable. Everybody's hugging each other and jumping up and down and screaming. And you just loved the whole world right then.
Next to the year of Hall and Plante, that Liute goaltending year, I really thought he should have won the Hart Trophy that year. He finished second to Gretzky in the closest balloting up to that time in the history of the Hart Trophy, which is to the league's MVP.
There was a decision made by the people who own the hockey club that it would be sold. And the potential city that was going to buy it was Saskatoon.
And the bumper stickers that were around town were, "Where the hell is Saskatoon?" I mean, who knew the small community other than Bernie Federico, who grew up there, and some of us who might have gone there for an exhibition game. It was very frightening to think that this city would lose its NHL team.
You've probably never seen a grown man cry over losing a hockey team, but this is one grown man that almost cried, because that is one love I have.
You know, I'll never leave St. Louis, and I'm sure I have a deep down gut feel way down in my heart that the franchise will never leave here, believe me.
I picked up the Los Angeles Times in the morning, and there was this little squib that said Ralston Purina, the Ralston Purina Company had decided to sell the St. Louis Blues. Over the course of 6 months, I went from an interested observer to a partial participant to finally, when no one else was prepared to write a check and put up their money to own the team, I wound up as the majority owner.
I got my appointment on the 13th of August. In the meantime, I was continuously ask who would be the coach. And I said, well, just give me the job and I'll find that coach. And Jacques Demers was my first selection from the start.
Mr. Ornes deserves a lot of credit for that. He brought the team where really nobody wanted it. He was a good boss. He was a man that you could talk to and sit down and, you know, if you had something to go to him, he was like a father in a way. And then you had Jack Quinn you could talk to, and certainly very respectable, knows how to run a business. And at the other level, you had Ron Caron that I feel gave me an opportunity to get back to the NHL. And I'll never forget one very special person that did me so many favors by understanding me, my emotional part of the game when I was down and all that. It was Barclay Plager, the greatest man I ever met in my life.
I got along very well with Jock. We were right from the opening time day. I handled the defense and he handled the forwards, and that's the way he wanted it.
Way to ram it for the drive, score! Reed's in front, he shoots, he scores! Boulder at four, Detroit. Moves in, gives it to Eiserman, out in front, Liut the save, rebound, and Liut covered up on it. Cleared it, and here's a break for Blake Dunlop. In the clear, Dunlop shoots Liut, big save on Dunlop. Isio, a shot, and Liut, all on his own, stopped him again. The Duguay in front, a shot, oh, and Liut just got a piece of that. Shooting Liut, the save, rebound, a spectacular save. Now Dunlop and Gilmore behind the net. Gilmore to Pettersson, right in, he scores! Pettersson! And the Blues win the series. Deep pass to Babich, he's in the clear. Check from behind, now Federico. Shoots, they score! Cleared, held in by the Blues. Bothwell shot, rebound, they score! Here is Joe Mullen. For St. Louis, back to Pichette, shoots, Beaupre the save, rebound, they score! Wickenheiser. Trying to center to Reed, did he score? Mark Reeds!
The first year I was here, we indicated to the fans that we will not accept subpar performance. And the thing that I could remember of the city is just that everybody seemed to like and support what I did as a coach.
I take great pride in representing the city of St. Louis, representing the franchise, the St. Louis Blues. And I feel that's a great responsibility for all the players that wear the blue note, to uphold the image and of this great sports town.
They don't have no big heads, you know, because they don't come from the LAs or the Chicagos and that. They come from towns of maybe 200 or 300 people.
Most of them came from Canada, from small towns where, like Bernie Federico from Foam Lake. I've been in Foam Lake many, many times in Saskatchewan, and I understand Bernie told me the other day they just put in their second stop sign there.
He just brought up to respect your elders, and if you don't, you get a whip across the butt from mom and dad.
I was raised on the farm. We ran off the bus to hauling bales and doing chores and everything like that. We knew we had to do that. We never had to be pushed or said, we do, dad and mom say, you do this or you do that. When it was harvesting time, it was time to haul bales or drive the tractor, spend endless hours doing tasks like that that everybody else thought their work. I still, to this day, hockey season is more of a holiday to me.
Oh, it's great for the fans, it's great for the teams, because you play hard against each other. And you know, you go into Chicago and it's just crazy there. You come here and they get Chicago fans here, and it's something to see, that's for sure.
Oh, boys. Listen, boys, it's going to be hard to talk. Doug Gilmore's line.
So the only thing that's great, now I could see hockey all the time. I could cheer against the Blackhawks and not worry about my life.
We're getting our chances. Keep working, boys. We're getting our chances here. You don't do nothing, Lee, it's nothing to them. We're going to get it back. Come on. Well, Bannon is going to get tired, boys. You keep working on him.
Dad says the Blackhawks eat bugs.
Every time there's a national anthem before the game in St. Louis, and you're standing on the blue line, you look up into the rafters. Number 8's hanging up there, and that's Barclay Plager's jersey, and it certainly sends a shiver down my spine. And to think of, you know, what a great competitor he was.
He's been kind of a father figure to me. over my professional career, this is the 11th year, he's definitely the biggest person behind what I've done as far as playing hockey.
You'll never see a San Luis Blues jersey on the floor in our dressing room, and that's something that's come from Barkley.
I'm very proud. I think I'll always be proud of the Blues.
Barkley is the love of our life, of everyone. Everyone has the utmost respect. He is one of the most remarkable men I've ever met.
I know the fans are upset to see a player like Joey Mullen leave, who, you know, face it, you score 40 goals a year and, you know, you got to be popular. And he was a great hockey player. And, you know, the fans really didn't know who we were.
Seconds to go on the power play. Gear shot, he scores! Boy, it's a power play goal!
It's tough to go and punch your friend in the face, and, you know, most jobs you don't have to do that when you get, you know, when you go from one company to another. But in my case, being I'm a physical player, you know, I'm not a goal scorer, but I had to go out there and run those guys and, you know, and slow them down and do whatever it took to win.
We were in contention for first place up to the last week. We ended up third, 3 or 4 or 5 points behind Chicago, and went about it to say, so we lost twice to Minnesota. We can't afford to lose a third time.
Running, dumps the puck in, Hunter after it, beaten to it by Afton. They collide behind the net, it's centered. Here's a good chance, Norwood a shot, he scores! Lee Norwood from the slot goes upstairs to beat Don Beaupre. Up the middle for McKechnie. At center to Bellows. He's into the blue zone, feeding it through to Marouk. Big save, Wamsley. Rebound, they fan on it, and it's cleared away by Pavice. Wow. Minnesota again, center. A shot. Wamsley the save, rebound. Neil Broughton in across the line for Nielsen. He's checked, gets it back again. Bjugstad loses. Here's a break for the Blues. Gilmore in the clear. Doug Gilmore in on goal. He scores! Short-handed goal by Gilmore. Now Wilson to Broughton. This game is over. And the St. Louis Blues walk into Bloomington, Minnesota and defeat the North Stars 2-1.
His own zone. Ramage headman pass to Federico. Federico has a breakaway. Federico in on goal. Shoots and scores! Goal Blues. Bernie Federico. This game is tied.
Federico to Doug Gilmore. Gilmore loses control of it. Hunter took a poke at it. Norwood a shot, and he scores! Goal Blues!
Then Gilmore battling Broughton for the puck. Gilmore with a puck, trying to move in front, does, has a chance, gives it to Norwood, he shoots and scores! Lee Norwood on a fantastic setup from Doug Gilmore, and the Blues have come back to within one goal. Gilmore back to the right point to Ramage, into the far corner, out to Pazlowski, shoots and scores! Ramage and Gilmore assist as Pazlowski ties it at 2. Gilmore unable to win the faceoff from Broughton, but the puck comes in front, Pazlowski shoots and scores! The North Stars, a giveaway. The Blues have taken a 3-2 lead. The puck brought out by Gilmore, 2-on-1 with Beers. Beers in front, takes the pass, shoots, he scores! Gilmore sets up Eddie Beers, and the Blues have a 4-2 lead. What a play again by Doug Gilmore. Pazlowski gets it in over the line to Gilmore, 2-on-1 to Pazlowski, a shot, he scores! The hat trick! Oh, it's incredible! Pazlowski! And what a happy bunch of Blues tonight here in Minnesota as they take the fifth and deciding game. This one is over. 1 second to go. That's it. The St. Louis Blues win the fifth game of this best-of-five series, and they swarm around Greg Millen. Jacques Demers will come on the ice, and the Blues have plenty of reason to celebrate here tonight.
My first 2 years I've been here, we played against Minnesota and been beaten out both times by them. So it was just one of those things that said, no way, this can't be done again, there's no way.
Couldn't really sleep that day, you know, it was like do or die that night, you know, so
I was in the hallway while, you know, just walking around, and Dougie Gilmore was sitting out there, and he couldn't sleep, so we just sat there and talked for a bit.
We discussed it before the game. We wanted to beat these guys, and I was playing with Greg Pavlovsky, who had a, you know, a fine game. And, you know, we talked before the game. We said, we got to do it. You know, we're missing a guy like Brian Sutter, and somebody else has to, you know, carry the load. And luckily, it worked out that way.
Across, they come into the Toronto zone and watch the play around the goal net. It's going to be right on the goal line before this play finishes. Watch this. Reagan moves his legs. There's the puck. It's on the goal line. Now watch the Leafs fall down on the puck.
Roof to Clark. He missed it, and it goes down the ice. And back there, the Leafs first. Lehman with Clark. Clark couldn't get a shot. Raglan fanned on it as he tried to shoot it in. Hatzopoulos was watching him, but now he's in there.
Blues power play to Federko behind the net. Federko still behind the goal. Centers a shot. The Blues score. And there he is, Mark Hunter. Now Wickenheiser comes up. Gilmore, great move, a shot. He scores! Doug Gilmore, what a tremendous move. With Cavallini over the line, 2-on-2, the shot, oh, and Cavallini after the save can't score, but scoring is Mahar. On the second rebound, Rick Mahar makes it 6-3, St. Louis.
Five is in front of the net, at the blue line, Lehman fakes the shot, Burgess is going in, centered at five, and he couldn't get a shot, but saw Lehman, oh, what a save by Dillon on that shot.
He's got his club going here, Bob.
Here's Nakris's shot, score! Nakris! And the Blues now are within one of the Maple Leafs. For St. Louis, Therrien with Cardinal. Here's Therrien. Therrien going in, and a great play by Nakris. Here's Dowell stealing it. And Dowell gets in front. Dowell breaking in. Rebound. Therrien. Millen down. Puck loose. Scramble. Bourgeois comes up with it. Boy, the Leafs come close to getting a shorthanded goal. The puck popped up right on his stick. But Millen was alive and well. Kozlowski shot. Rebound. Score. St. Louis, Eddie Beers and the capacity crowd here up the arena goes wild.
Let's see what happens. Smith in there again,
centered it. Here's the chance. I have Brady. Rebound is there. Millen makes two big sensational saves.
We're in after it. That is Hunter. Back of the net.
It's centered. They score.
Wow.
Kevin LaValle, giving the Blues a 2-1 lead. Leafs try to get something going here. Lehman shot, kicked away by Millen. That goaltender for St. Louis has been hot on the entire series. Courtnell shot, and you talk about hot. Look at that save off Courtnell. Not much room to penetrate for the Maple Leafs. However, they're in there. So is Smith shooting it. Oh, what a save by Millen. It was deflected. Tremendous countdown here in St. Louis, and the Blues have won it. They will advance.
When we got ourselves in trouble, who came to our rescue was Greg Millen, and he won the series for us, I believe. He made some great saves, had everybody excited on the Toronto team. They didn't know who the heck was going to score on him because he challenged them, and it was in everybody's mind in the Toronto Maple Leafs, can we really beat this guy? So Millsy's such a great competitor. I love the little guy.
Toronto really started to come on in the playoffs, and they were really gelling, and they were young and enthusiastic, and, you know, it was sure glad when we won that 17.
I just kind of sit there and, you know, think back to myself and, you know, say, how did we do it? Somebody must have been looking out for us. You know, something was going on.
24 seconds left in the Calgary power play. And they're all around Walmsley in front line. How they shot! And Walmsley the save. Here's Bernie Federko to Mark Hunter over the Calgary line. Hunter splits the defense, breaks it all alone, shoots. He scores! Mark Hunter on a breakaway, and the Blues lead 3-2. Ramage shooting the puck in, could be icing, but Lube is beaten to it. Now LaValle looking to center, looking for Raglan or Mahar. Raglan in the corner to Mahar, he scores! Rick Mahar! Ramage can really shoot. Ooh, and he tests Vernon there. Oh, what a wicked drive. Hunter to Cavallini, to Norwood. Lee Norwood right on the save. Loose puck, Cavallini scores! Now Natras intercepts. He's got Mahar breaking right in. Mahar shoots and scores! Rick Mahar! 6 seconds to go. The crowd bringing hockey back to St. Louis from the days of the late 60s, early 70s, and Jacques Plante, Glenn Hall, Doug Harvey. What a night for the Blues. They've tied this series at two victories aside.
23 seconds left in the two-man advantage for St. Louis. They trail 4-1, third period. Natras, the save! A skate save by Vernon on Natras. Wickenheiser, the shot, he scores! It's 4-2.
Blues getting hemmed in their own zone again. Peplinski centers to Mullen. He shoots and scores. And you can see that one coming. 5-2 Calgary. A big, big goal. Look at Bob Johnson. Joe Mullen gets the goal. And Natras playing it to Gilmore. On to Pazlowski. A shot kicked out. Rebound. Center shoots and scores. Oh, and the roller coaster ride continues. There are 8 minutes remaining in the third period and maybe in the hockey season for the St. Louis Blues. And Gilmore deflects the puck in, Sutter into the corner. Centers, they score! Pazlowski, and they'll go crazy! The St. Louis Blues have been in this game what they have been all season and throughout the playoffs. An underdog. They've called this club a lunch bucket team. They're blue-collar hard workers. They don't have the talent of other teams. They know it. Boy, you get the idea. If the Blues can come up with a miracle finish, these Calgary Flames would have to crawl back to Alberta. 1:17 to go. The Blues need a goal to continue on. 1:10 remaining. A shot, they score! Pavlovsky! The Blues, a remarkable comeback. Now only 5 seconds away from overtime. The save by Vernon, and this sixth game unbelievably goes to overtime. Here's a drive. McKinnis wide, and Walmsley has the puck come right in front off the boards. Bernie Federko spun around. Here's Wickenheiser shooting, and Vernon the big save. Calgary can end it if they win it. Here they come, McCowan to Mullen. Mullen shot, hit the goal post. He hit the post, and Walmsley makes another save. Here's Ramage for Federko, too far. Federko steals the puck from Reinhardt. Over to Hunter, who shoots block. Wickenheiser scores! Doug Wickenheiser! The Blues pull it off, and it's unbelievable!
Can you imagine what it would be like if they would ever win the Stanley Cup here? Can you imagine?